Did 2019 suck for you? Are you looking forward to a better 2020? The only thing that matters is that you know that you are on your personal path to becoming who you want to be. And be bold about it. Here's to a 2020 of pure fearlessness. And full of love.
Hi, I'm Alina, which means our hope is in Jesus, not religion. As I share my personal journey towards a higher level of love and spirituality, I hope it helps you on your path. Welcome to my channel.
Hey! So I had this crazy original idea to talk to you about New Year's resolutions, right? But I think it's good to reflect back on 2019, and it was just the craziest year. If I go back a little further, like December 2018, I had just done the scariest thing in my life. I really set out on this journey to overcome all my fears, and I used to be such a fearful living person, and especially being scared of other people's opinion of me. So I really resolved to overcome that, especially thinking of this text in 1 John chapter 4. It doesn't only say that God is love, and whosoever lives in love lives in God and God in them. It also says that we can cast out all fear by love, through love. I don't know, I all of a sudden had this crazy idea to put it to the test, to see if I could overcome my fears with love. When God told me to go up to the pulpit in the Mormon church that I was active in back then, in case you haven't seen my previous videos, I was born and raised in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, also known as the Mormon Church, and I left about 2.5 months ago. So that is a big red thread in my 2019, I guess. But yeah, in 2018 December, I was still an active Mormon woman, and I felt God told me to speak out against the church's own gay policy from the pulpit. And so in this moment, I thought, okay, fear is definitely telling me to keep seated and keep my mouth shut. I felt tremendous fear. I was trembling all over. Then I thought, well, what would be my reason to listen to this inner voice and do it anyway? And my reason was love. Love for any gay person that might have been struggling at that moment and be seated right there. And any person that maybe has a gay relative that they could treat with more love and empathy. I thought, okay, fear will have me stay seated and love will have me go up to the pulpit. So I was like, okay, I'm gonna choose love. And I went up to the pulpit and I spoke out, and 4 months later, the gay policy was actually changed, and that really boosted my confidence. And so I kept making all these choices divided by fear versus love. Like I kept reflecting on my own motives. Why am I doing this, or why am I omitting that? I really started rearranging every aspect of life. That is just so liberating. So liberating. If you determine, like me, like for me, I had determined previously that my core value is love. I just want to leave a legacy of love. When I started to live more congruent with my core value, wow, that just gives a kind of magic to life, especially in this quest of overcoming my fear of human opinion. That has been really liberating, to really face my fear heads on. And so another scary thing I did was, in May, I went to a Hillsong women's conference in London. When I signed up, I didn't even know anyone yet. And so that was scary for me. I hadn't traveled by myself in a decade. I was gonna be surrounded by thousands of women without knowing anyone. And so I had to really push myself out of my comfort zone to get to know people. Even though I had traveled the world before by myself, I was out of my comfort zone traveling alone again after a decade of not doing that. So that was a real confidence boost. Like, oh, you know, riding the tube is not that hard. Yeah, it was just a really great experience. But one of the best things about it was that the emphasis during this conference was all on empathy, growing our empathy. And there was this one expert that really encouraged these 6,000 Christian women of different denominations to seek out people on the internet that they disagreed with, not to go into feisty discussions with them, but to read about their opinion, to get to know where they're coming from, to really understand other people better, not to convince anyone of their opinion, but just to empathize. Man, I was so inspired by that. Like, wow, yes, that is the thing. That's the thing that's lacking in this world. It's empathy. We don't all need to think the same and feel the same and have the same convictions. If we could just empathize with each other a little more, that's the thing that could prevent wars. Also, another thing I was really inspired by at this conference was that all the keynote speakers were super open about their own struggles. Psychological struggles, anxiety, depression. I was just blown away by that. I was not used to people being so open about what usually are considered weaknesses. One speaker that was particularly open and really impacted me was Erwin McManus, and he wrote this book. That's why I bought his book, because he just blew me away. He had all these beautiful one-liners like, your freedom is on the other end of your fear, and you shouldn't run away from your fear, you should run towards it. And faith and fear are just two sides of the same coin. Faith is a positive projection of the future, where fear is a negative projection of the future. So everyone is in the faith business, like even any atheist. Like, we all do it. We all have our projections of the future. And when they're positive, we don't know if they're gonna turn out positive. So if we have a positive projection, that's faith. It's not a sure knowing, it's faith. And if we have a negative projection of the future, we don't know it's gonna turn out negative. So that's fear. So I really, really like that. And I just wanna read like a small quote out of this book. So Erwin McManus writes, "Sometimes God allows us to go through tremendous disruption so that we might choose the path to freedom. At other times, God simply uses an invitation and we have to choose our own disruption. We have to decide that we will not stay where we are and lose where we must be." So I really love that. He so encouraged me through his speech, but also this book, to really step way out of my comfort zone and just run towards my fear. And in part, this channel is definitely acting out what he preached, acting upon the encouragement and this great desire that I have to just be fearless. So in August, I raised this channel and I started again with speaking a little more love and empathy into the world for especially gays in church. And I also saw an opportunity to build up to this moment where I was gonna leave the Mormon church and to hopefully raise a little more empathy on both sides. Empathy among active Mormons for those leaving, and empathy among ex-Mormons for those staying. Because I've been on both sides and I've seen so much harm done from people just not understanding each other's motives and just assuming the worst, kind of, and accusing each other a lot. And the world could be so much better if we didn't focus on what we think someone else is thinking, but if we actually just listened a little more to each other. And so that was mainly my spiritual journey for 2019. And I will continue this journey in the next year. So think for a moment about your New Year's resolutions. Maybe you haven't made any. In all honesty, I usually don't think about it until March. My New Year's resolutions go from March to March. So my New Year's resolution will remain the same as it was the last 2 years, which is I want to stop comparing myself to others. And I do feel that I've made progress in this area, obviously by just putting myself out there, going straight against my fear. You know, I thought, oh, okay, I'm scared of people's opinion. Let's just share my innermost feelings on the internet. And see what comes from it. And so far, so good. People have been pretty nice. Yeah, and some have been really encouraging. Thank you. Thank you so much. Like, you are really helping me on my spiritual journey. And I hope I can do the same for you just by sharing what I have. It might not be much, but what I have, you may have. Yeah, so I'm sharing my struggles openly and people have been nice about it. It has boosted my confidence and I've become less dependent on people's opinions, but at the same time, it is an extra challenge to have this channel. And you see all these other channels, especially of ex-Mormons who are just bashing and being negative, and they have like thousands of subscribers. And I keep thinking, am I doing something wrong? So, I don't know, like putting myself out there has been a good experience, but it's also been scary, and it also poses me with this extra challenge to not care about other people's opinions. I really try to focus on my own channel and not look at other people's channels anymore, which I did for a little while. And to be honest, all the negative bashing really got to me. I don't know, my reality shifted. All of a sudden, I felt so awful that I've been part of this cult all my life. And then I was like, okay, I think what I'm watching is having a negative influence on me. And so I'm sharing this because many of you are also subscribed to all these ex-Mormon channels. You have to just be aware of what it does to you. Anger is a stage of grief that many people go through. And so these other channels that really vent anger, they have their place in this world and they can really make you feel understood when you are in that same place of anger. Maybe more so than I could. Because, you know, if I'm just gonna be happy and bubbly and you're being angry at home, you're not gonna feel understood. But it's important that you don't stay in that place for too long and that you try to acknowledge your feelings and then turn the page. The only reason I'm saying that is because I've seen the damage done in people when they lingered in their anger for too long. I care about you, I care about everyone, and I don't want you to feel that way. I sincerely want everyone to be happy. Yeah, so negative emotions are a part of life, and it's important that we acknowledge those and don't suppress them. That's very unhealthy, but also like just don't stay in those feelings for too long. Yeah, that's what I experienced this year, you know, and raising this channel and then starting to look at other people's channels. And so, you know, you can make a U-turn any moment in life. And I did, and I resolved to not look at those channels any longer. Immediately, I felt happier. Whatever you do this year, choose consciously. And when you make your New Year's resolutions, think of how you want to feel in 2020. Write down your core values, whatever they may be. Try to think of every decision, like, is this gonna help me get closer to my core values, or is it gonna lead me away from my core values? And this is something anyone can do, no matter what state of mind you're in, no matter what convictions you hold currently. Maybe you're leaning towards atheism. Especially then, you need a foundation in life. So figure out what your core values are, write them out, and maybe hang them somewhere where you can see them. And try to live more congruent with your core values. I promise you that in 2020, you will feel better. Even if you are already feeling fabulous now, you will feel even better. If you're feeling like crap right now, you will feel better. We just need to be true to who we are. And in order to do that, we need to figure out who we are. We need to have something tangible to keep us on that path. That's something that just helped me a lot. to figure out what my core values are and be bold about it, like sticking to it. Yeah, here's to a 2020 of pure fearlessness and full of love. I am really curious, what are your New Year's resolutions? And don't make them smart, you know? Forget about the smart goals, you know? Specific, measurable, attainable, and whatnot, time-based, I'm forgetting one. Don't make your goal smart. Make it a character goal. Decide who you want to be. And then realize that even though that might not be a smart goal, it is definitely a very, very wise goal. And it will bring you far more happiness than any smart goal in the world. So one of the wise, not smart goals I had set for 6 years straight was to stop judging people. And I would reflect every Sunday on how I was doing, and I would pray for help to do better. 6 years later, I was not the same person. Maybe that's not fast progress, but what's 6 years in a lifetime? I mean, I might still have 80 years ahead of me, as I'm an optimist. And I'm so happy I invested those 6 years in becoming a less judgmental person. And so for the past 2 years, my wise goal was to stop comparing myself to others, because I noticed I was being a lot nicer to others, but not so nice to myself yet. That's how we grow, like one baby step at a time. And it's okay, it doesn't matter if your goal takes 1 year or a decade, or maybe a lifetime. The only thing that matters is that you know that you are on your personal path to becoming who you want to be. And that will give you joy and fulfillment even when you haven't reached your goal yet. Just working towards it is the most rewarding thing. So just take a deep breath. And when you breathe out, let go of all the things of 2019 you'd rather forget about and you don't need in 2020. And just keep your eyes on this new year that's gonna be better than the last. Even better if the last one was already good. So I wish you all a very, very happy new year. I really wanna hear about your new year's resolutions in the comments below. And you know, I do care about your opinion. So thumbs up, subscribe if you're looking forward to the next video, hit the little bell button so you'll be notified when next video comes out. And I will see you in 2020, and let's make it the best year ever.